Welcome to FaithWorks on WFNE 103.5 FM in Wake Forest. I'm Ellen White, your host, where we highlight individuals in and around the area that put their faith into action. Today I have the distinct honor of interviewing Dr. Fulvio de Blasi.
Welcome, Fulvio.
Thank you, Ellen. Thank you very much.
Dr. Fulvio de Blasi is an internationally renowned scholar in the field of Thomistic philosophy and natural law theory. Dr. de Blasi has a law degree from Milan and a PhD from Palermo. That's quite a distinguished career. You could have stopped at the law firm. Tell me a little bit about yourself, how you ended up in the United States, and then we can go on from there.
Sure. Well, after my PhD in philosophy in Palermo, I wanted to be able to write firsthand in English and do research this way, in compared to the whole world, as an international scholar. And I had a strong English background. I was already a translator of several philosophical major works from English into Italian. Mm-hmm. And my grammar was very good, but I had never been in an English-speaking country, so my active English in terms of speaking and writing was not nearly as good as my reading skill and grammar. So I wanted to have an experience abroad, and what I did several things. On the one hand, I applied to the National Council of Research, which is a governmental is the major governmental institution of research in Italy.
Okay.
With branches all over the country, but they have the central, you know, headquarters in Rome.
Okay.
And so I applied to Rome for having a fellowship that would make me a researcher for the National Council in Italy, and that would give me the possibility of spending some time abroad to do research in an English-speaking country. But that was a free option, so I could have picked up any possible country.
Okay.
At the same time, I applied for a sort of habilitation program in the German-speaking countries, and I was accepted immediately. So after my PhD, I spent some time doing postdoctoral research in Liechtenstein, in a Catholic philosophical academy, which was formerly a university in Liechtenstein.
Okay.
While I was in Liechtenstein, and I had a great experience in Liechtenstein doing research there. I met a lot of very good friends, scholars and students, and I taught some classes there. And while I was there, the National Council of Research called me back and told me that they awarded me this fellowship. And so I decided to go to Notre Dame. The reason why I did it is that one of my works as a translator was to translate a technical book on the concept of analogy in St. Thomas Aquinas by a famous American Thomist, Ralph McInerney, who was teaching at Notre Dame.
Okay.
And I knew that Notre Dame was a very good place for doing research in natural law theory, so I talked to Ralph and he told me, oh sure, come over. He appointed me as a research associate in a philosophy institute affiliated with the philosophy department at Notre Dame. And so I went there the first time as an Italian researcher for the National Council of Research, and with the idea of spending just 1 year in the US and then going back to Italy. While I was there, Ralph told me, Fulvio, you know what, we would like to have you for a few more years. And actually, after a few months at Notre Dame, they asked me from the philosophy department to teach some courses, if I wanted to teach some courses there. My main focus was on research, and I needed to learn
a lot,
the language. So I accepted to stay for about 3 or 4 more years at Notre Dame, and I had a great time. So this is actually the first way in which I arrived to the US, but I was not planning on staying here full time, so my goal was to go back to Italy after, you know, having enough of the English background to do that.
Okay, we jumped ahead a little bit on your professional background, but I'd like to go back a little bit farther and have you touch on your upbringing. It's obvious you're from Italy.
Yes.
Where exactly are you from in Italy, and what was your family like?
Well,
family life like growing up?
I consider myself Sicilian, even more than Italian.
Yes.
So for many reasons, people don't know that much. But Italy is more than the political unity. So actually, I'm one of those people who considers the political union in Italy one of the major disasters in modern history. So Italy is much more than that. So. So that's why I like to say that I'm Sicilian.
Okay.
Even though my family is not 100% Sicilian, my mother is actually from the very northeast of Italy, from a city called Trieste.
Okay.
And that's why my mother and my father decided never to talk their respective dialects, which in Italy very often are different languages at home. So I have I had just an exposure to the national standard language at home.
Okay.
But but my mother's family from her mother's side is more from does have German roots, so it's definitely more from the north of Italy and Germany.
Okay.
While on her father's side is more from the south, from Sicily too. So I would say that 3/4 of my blood are Sicilian, and 1/4 is from Italy, North Italy / Germany. And I was born in neutral territory in Tuscany. At that time, my family had a lot of connections in Tuscany. My mother's parents were living there. And so I was born in Livorno. I kind of regret it. I would have liked to be born in Sicily,
Sicily.
As well.
Of course, you have a heart for Sicily. And raised Catholic, strong Catholic family on both sides. Okay. Touch a little bit about your draw towards philosophy, your desire to be a philosopher. It started early on, from what I understand?
It started very early, actually. I would say that since I was in high school, early in high school, actually, I was driven a lot by the connection between faith and reason. I really needed to understand everything that I could about the faith. And also, I wanted to be able to explain the reasonableness of the faith to all my friends. I wanted to have the right answer each time for my friends. Because in Italy, especially in high school, we have a very strong liberal arts education. So what you would, in the States, what you have in college, we actually have the same approach culturally in high school. So the liberal arts education is supposed to be delivered in high school in Italy. That means that in high school, for example, I studied 5 years of Greek, 5 years of Latin. I studied all the history of philosophy. I studied, of course, also science, mathematics, and all the things.
Right.
So the ideal of liberal arts education is in high school in Italy. That also means that high school students talk about these things all the time. I remember amazing discussions about atheism, Nietzsche and Sartre and all the modern and ancient philosophers in high school.
Yes.
That's why I, as a Catholic person, I really wanted to have the right answers. I need to know what can I really say about these things of the faith? Because many people challenge their faith in high school in Italy, and people would, get really proud of their, in a sense, studies and say, well, Catholicism is really naive or wrong or mistaken historically or conceptually. And so since I was actually the best in my class in high school in philosophy. I got the highest grades in philosophy in high school. And that's how I started. I really needed to have this harmony. And then after high school, I went to law. I also pursued a career in law, also because I was fascinated by my father as an attorney. He was a man of principle and a very good attorney. He used to talk to me at home about legal things. Even as a high school student, I was able to talk about our constitution in Italy. So I was driven also by this passion for law, and I don't regret studying law, even though my focus eventually has been more on philosophy, not only because I was able also to help my father in the firm, and eventually also I needed to take over for a little while after he died, but especially because law is also provides a very good intellectual framework for studying philosophy in many ways that we don't want to touch upon today.
Right.
But law is really is really interesting. It does have, and in a, roughly speaking, law also is part of morality in general. Mm-hmm. So if you study moral philosophy, if starting with Aristotle, the treatise on justice is part of ethics, is part of moral philosophy. Mm-hmm. So law technically is the object of a virtue in Aquinas, the virtue of justice. But unlike every other item in moral theory, law is the only one that forces people to be extremely precise and objective. And the reason is kind of obvious, because law is something that is between me and you. Law is not just like how many ice cream should I eat to mm-hmm. be temperate.
Right, right.
Law is about what should I do compared to you. And that means that the way to measure my moral action, measure is actually a classical concept mm-hmm. here, is the measuring system of the moral action,
right, right.
is actually external to me, is in between you and me, is mm-hmm. a contract, is the law of the country, is the natural law, mm-hmm. but right. Is something that, since it is outside of me, mm-hmm. allows for a more objective viewpoint and allows moral theory to be much more precise about what you should do.
Hmm? Right.
So when you study the entire history of law from the viewpoint of canon law and natural law theory, you actually get much more of the right forma mentis, I would say in Latin, the way to shape your mind,
right,
to think
right.
of moral issues,
right.
and to work on natural law theory, then I think even the philosophy studies wouldn't provide easily to
right.
your mindset. So I would say that my law background is big part of what I did also as a philosopher and as a reader of Aquinas and natural law theory in general.
Right, right. It is. It set the good framework mm-hmm. for you. Well, let's jump ahead a little bit from this quite distinguished background that you have and continue to have to the Thomas International Center here mm-hmm. in Raleigh. How did it get started? What's the brainchild? Where did it come together? I know that there are a lot of pieces to this puzzle.
Yeah, actually, I like to mention an anecdote about the very birth of the Thomas International Project, then became a center.
Okay.
It was a dinner with Ralph McKinney at the Notre Dame University Club.
Okay.
He used to invite me to have dinner with him, and he would pay, of course, and as a senior scholar.
That's generous.
And a member of the club. to pay him back, I would just enjoy with him philosophical discussions and discussions about our faith and the current
fantastic.
Situation of the church and Catholic education and so forth. And he agreed with me that we don't have, especially in the institutions of higher learning, a strong Catholic identity anymore. We missed the idea, the original ideal of the university in the Catholic world, and some major institutions like Notre Dame, where I was, are so powerful. That probably they, I really like Notre Dame. It's not like I want to talk badly about Notre Dame, but you see something in these major institutions that is not driven by just the Catholic identity,
right.
but maybe by the idea of competing with the other Ivy League
right.
universities. Of course, public standards are not the Catholic standards, and also you notice a fragmentation of knowledge. For example, when I was teaching Notre Dame, some students used to object to some moral issues, telling me that in the anthropology department or in the sociology department or in the physics department, they had a different approach. Now, so that was intriguing for me. I mean, I like the idea of being challenged by other disciplines. But, of course, in a Catholic university, there should be some kind of unity of knowledge. It's not like every department works as an atom in a different universe from the philosophy and theology departments, especially. But that doesn't matter anymore. These big institutions just need departments that can compete with the corresponding departments in other universities, and that's it. So I've never talked to this. Once I told one of the students, why don't you arrange for a meeting with your professor right. from the other department,
right.
and we'll talk.
Right.
And that never happened. And nobody cared about something like that.
And it makes it confusing, too, for the individual students.
Absolutely. The students don't. Some Catholic students in Notre Dame sometimes need advisors. And I have great colleagues in Notre Dame who used to spend a lot of time to give advice to students.
Mm.
In a sense, to create their own curriculum inside the university to be sure that they were getting a good Catholic formation. You know, when I was in Notre Dame, just to give you an idea of how big these institutions get to be, that something even very relevant become even not noticed by other people.
Right.
Something shocking for me was that at that time, one of the required courses in philosophy, you know, at Notre Dame, students have to take some courses in philosophy, even though they study, you know, every other discipline, of course, as in many institutions. One-on-one course in philosophy required from all the students was taught by an atheist professor whose main point was to explain that God doesn't exist. So, and I was wondering, wow, I mean, here we are in the major Catholic university in the United States, in which, of course, some courses are required in philosophy, because philosophy is the foundation also of theology and in human knowledge. And here it is, we require every student to take a course to show that God doesn't exist. I mean, what's the point of that? This is just an example,
right,
but with Ralph McCraney at that dinner, we agreed that there was a strong need to make good scholars focus on the idea of a Catholic university and how Catholic education should work. And so we established a center. At that time, we didn't have any resource specifically committed to that. And I told Ralph, I mean, Ralph, what do you want me to do? I mean, we should start talking to people or traveling. I don't know if we can do that. And, you know, he actually, he was a very generous person. So he told me, you're right. So he took his checkbook out and he wrote a check for me to start traveling and working on it. And then, you know, eventually in the following years, several very good Catholic scholars joined the club, and we created a network of good scholars with the idea of organizing lectures and seminars and publications, and eventually maybe to establish a new institution, not with the idea of competing with major Catholic universities, that may be in 500 years. But with the idea that it's very hard to change the route of major institutions right now, but it's very easy to give even small examples from other viewpoints. And so a new institution might set interesting examples for even the major ones. And also it might give new resources to very good Catholic colleges that are spread all around the country, but they are too small to make a strong impact, to have a strong impact on culture. But we figure that we can create a positive, virtuous network also between these good institutions and increase the impact of the Catholic education in the world in general. And eventually we decided to locate in Raleigh because we thought it was, you know, I don't know if you care to talk about it.
Yeah, I do. I wanted to mention what the mission of Thomas International Center is first, and then we can go into why Raleigh, North Carolina. I think that would be good. So the mission of the Thomas International Center is an educational institution that pursues cultural renewal, by offering students and others opportunities to delve into the classical and Christian wisdom of Western civilization, from Aristotle and Thomas Aquinas to C.S. Lewis and John Paul II. It aims in the long term, like you had talked about, to build a world-respected international university in the Catholic intellectual tradition with its main campus in the United States and a secondary campus in Italy. So why don't you touch on a little bit about what you mean exactly by the classical and Christian wisdom of Western civilization?
Well, I already mentioned something of it. You know, at the beginning, university, what we call today university, was born somehow as a concept when Aquinas was alive, about close to 1,000 years ago, less than that, right? So, and at that time, the idea was that there is a universal wisdom that can inform all the branches of knowledge and can give you a perspective from which you can look at the world and understand it, either from its particular things, each science or discipline, or from the overall viewpoint of philosophy and especially theology. So university also means universal knowledge, something that, you know, belongs to all the disciplines. Now we are way far from that point. I mean, now there is a really a big fragmentation of knowledge, and we lost the origin, the classical wisdom, and this is due to long history that definitely goes way beyond what we can talk about today. but I think that a big concern for Catholic and even Christian in general is to recover their intellectual roots and to recover also a unity of vision in the world in which there is no schizophrenia between people as physicists or chemists or sociologists and they're being Catholic and sharing the same truth somehow. So, and this is part of our mission, is to recover the roots of the Catholic identity as also a universal knowledge that should inform the institutions of higher learning in a way that can give something more to each discipline. So when I was in Notre Dame, sometimes we faced in discussions this kind of questions. Do we want to be a good university or a Catholic university? A good philosophy department or a Catholic philosophy department? This question is the death of Catholic culture. I mean, a good university should be the best Catholic university. A good philosophy department should be the best Catholic philosophy department. So we need to recover that kind of wisdom and unity in which we see the revelation of Christianity as something that really reveals to the world what the world really is and is supposed to be. So it's a higher look on the world. It's not something that frustrates the world. So I would love to be a great physicist, but unfortunately I'm Catholic, so I'm limited by these views. I would like to be a good ethicist, but I have to believe that contraception is wrong. I mean, these things are just a schizophrenia in the Catholic mind. We need to fix that. We need to find harmony. We need to be, wow, I'm the best physicist because I know more about the world and I can give I can provide better explanations. So Catholic thought should add something to culture. It shouldn't be a mortification of culture. Unfortunately, in many highly respected Catholic institutions, being Catholic is seen as a mortification, as a frustration. So sometimes scholars tend to hide the fact that they're Catholic so that they can be respected. And this is what we need to fix. I mean, and this is part of our mission. And it's not just for us. I mean, whether we succeed or not in building eventually a highly respected university, we can help a lot of other institutions and scholars to recover this idea. And we are not starting with very rich, multi-billionaires helping us. But we started with some very good Catholic intellectuals and with a very good vision. Our plan has to be feasible in terms of also financial capacity. So we chose to have even a very slow process that starts with something that is very cheap at the beginning and viable, but which according to our contemporary world can be extremely exciting and can increase our potential in the future, which is the online teaching. So online is in many ways the future of universities in general and in teaching in general. And this is not necessarily, several scholars see this as a bad thing, because of course having the students in front of you in class adds something to your relationship with the students and the potential of affecting the students and teaching. But online doesn't necessarily work in opposition to this. Many institutions suffer because they, education is too expensive.
Yes, it is.
And small institutions might close because they don't have enough resources to keep that up. And major institutions might find out that eventually people are not willing to pay $60,000 a year or more just to have a college degree for their kids. So I think that online teaching if we don't see it as a, just an alternative to traditional teaching, mm-hmm. Well, first of all, online has a potential to reach the whole world in terms of cultural impact. Yes. So I'm fascinated by the idea yes. that I can teach a class and everybody can see it in the whole world, mm-hmm. and even in countries which they don't have Catholic culture mm-hmm. at all, mm-hmm. and they mm-hmm. have different intellectual traditions, mm-hmm. so they can benefit a lot from mm-hmm. what we can provide. So this is a fascinating thing mm-hmm. that would just mm-hmm. justify by itself mm-hmm. the Catholic presence mm-hmm. online, which, yeah. by the way, is very poor right now. Yeah. I mean, Catholics are the worst right now in terms of online presence. Even the Jehovah Witnesses are better than Catholics online.
With a presence online, what do you yes. mean exactly by that?
That they have, their websites have a better impact. So they have many more people going to their websites.
Oh,
so that means that Catholics are not good in engaging people online, and they probably don't invest enough in this potential.
Okay.
While the new generations mm-hmm. works mm-hmm. online. I mean, so
right.
and that's what it is.
Yeah.
So first of all, the cultural impact and the potential is fascinating mm-hmm. for especially for people who are driven mm-hmm. by the idea that they do possess a truth that should reach the whole world.
Right.
I was actually excited the other day. I noticed that a lot of people went to our websites, watching our videos and reading our articles. Mm-hmm. I can see it because I see how much time they spend on mm-hmm. some pages. So from India. From Calcutta, actually, the city of Mother Teresa, right? Uh-huh. And so, I mean, a lot of people. And I thought, wow, who would say? We have never really even tried to engage mm-hmm. these people. Mm-hmm. And maybe some of them find out that we have something online, and they told their friends, and hey, so we will never know, but we are affecting in a lot of people in India, right?
This is the way it's the way it's shared,
right? And mm-hmm. of course, I mean, people are going to the website from the whole world. But going back to the idea of online teaching being an interesting outcome also for existing universities, you know, online teaching might add something to their, you know, teaching itself is becoming a product that goes beyond the limits of the physical university.
Yes.
So let's say that you have a very good course taught by a scholar you care from another university, and this course is available online, and you can pay a subscription and just benefit from this course. And your professors inside, first of all, you need to hire less professors, and so you can increase the number of your offer, but not necessarily hiring more people, just keeping, this is the way we are working on our development right now.
Okay.
We see that many institutions, especially smaller institutions, can benefit from having available courses online that they can buy in terms of delivery too, and without having the costs of having extra professors. They can have their own professors acting right. as instructors sometimes,
right.
or they can have just a richer curriculum
right.
Thanks to partner institutions online.
Yep.
And also, in the case in which they just want to take the best advantage of their own professor, so they might just buy courses from other institutions and have their ideal course from a professor that they would never have in their own institution. But also, they can benefit from online developments in using their own professors. And this is very interesting. Some institutions are already investing a lot of money in what they call the flipping methodology.
I'm not familiar. So
It's very interesting. It's very clever. You know, in a sense, when the traditional teaching works this way, you have your professor in a university mm-hmm. that teaches his classes every semester, right? Maybe
yes.
the same class all over
right.
all over again. But in a sense, the delivering of the lecture as such is something that doesn't really require the presence of the students. So if you had the lecture recorded just once, but very well, but you do have your own professor who taught that class, then you can reverse. I mean, you can have the homework in class and the lecture taken by the students whenever they want. So let's say that I have my class already taught online, and I tell my students, okay, let's watch this class as part of your homework, and then in class we will talk and actually work on your homework. Mm-hmm. And this actually takes the best advantage of having the students in class, because you actually work with them. You don't spend half an hour just talking, right? That part can be done outside of class. Mm-hmm. So some institutions are investing hundreds of millions, even in Asia, to create a system which somehow the homework is brought into class. And the delivery of the lecture is part of the homework.
Right, which makes sense, because that's when you need the direction of the professor.
Right. Yes, and you can have the professor teach one course very well, mm-hmm. not repeating the same lecture all over again, mm-hmm. but what he does with the mm-hmm. students is actually mm-hmm. work with them directly.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so this is a fascinating potential of having classes available mm-hmm. online. Mm-hmm. And sometimes the professors can even train the students using classes from other professors. I can't remember this scientist, but an American scientist, I think from MIT, was making this clear, saying, so why would I teach a class that a colleague of mine from this university taught extremely well, and he's the expert, and that class is available online? Why would I want to mimic that class myself? I can tell my students, watch this class, and then I work with them in class mm-hmm. to figure out mm-hmm. how they can handle that. Mm-hmm. But why would I want to teach the same class when it's available already, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. So this is actually, in the future, in our world is a world in which communication mm-hmm. broke any kind of barrier. Mm-hmm. So even physical universities can mm-hmm. benefit from this mm-hmm. Total connection and online available tools mm-hmm. can become a great mm-hmm. resource mm-hmm. for any institution. Mm-hmm. Sharing courses, sharing professors, mm-hmm. sharing instructors. Mm-hmm. And we want to work in this. We are already trying to establish some partnerships with existing institutions in which we can provide the host, you know, the platform even for them to increase their potential and to share courses. And I think this is a great development that we can do at a very cheap, price.
Well, I can see that the wheels are turning in my head how this could be utilized in a fantastic way as a Catholic institution that's providing sound Catholic teaching to other mm-hmm. universities.
Yes, and taking the best of their own institutions, because we can share their own courses too.
Yeah.
So virtuous institutions can collaborate in making our entire culture available consistently online and sharing the best resources they have with one another. Okay. This can be done, it's cheap, and eventually, of course, in Raleigh too, we can use this system to start also some physical teaching, and that's the way in which we can, at a very cheap price, also start a physical university, but hopefully in a way that will be viable compared to the future world in which the costs of higher education cannot stay as they are today.
They
have to go down.
And
so hopefully we'll be able to work out a formula that will make viable also our future physical courses here, but because they are supported by the online teaching that makes cheaper the use mm-hmm. of professors and the presence of the students.
It is. It's less expensive that way. Well, you mm-hmm. you mentioned Raleigh, North Carolina, so let's back up a little bit and talk about, of all the places in the United States that you could have chosen, why Raleigh, North Carolina?
Well, okay, we did a lot of research. I remember
feasibility studies and surveys.
Oh,
and
we traveled all around the countries with my colleague Christopher Wolf.
Okay.
We had great memories of many traveling.
Okay.
And very often we focused for a few months on just one possible place.
Okay.
We really got even some interesting offers in terms of donation and facilities from other places. But there were always obstacles in other mm-hmm. places. For mm-hmm. example, in some places, there were already some interesting and good Catholic institutions in the same area.
Okay.
And so why would we be in the same area where they are already served by mm-hmm. a good Catholic institution?
Mm-hmm.
So, and in other places, maybe there were some interesting donors, but and people interested, but there was nothing really going on in terms of university culture.
Hmm? Okay.
So it would be limited, the place, by being, you know, too isolated from from the, we definitely, part of our mission is actually to affect culture in a strong way, even university research. So And other places didn't have a good Catholic presence in general, so we definitely need the support of a Catholic mm-hmm. community. Other places didn't have bishops who believed that this is what they needed in mm-hmm. the diocese. Mm-hmm. And so we needed to put together all these factors. Mm-hmm. If you think about Raleigh, also we needed some places where families and students mm-hmm. would, you know, be.
Of course. So
Raleigh is actually a beautiful place. It does have a good climate. Mm-hmm. I remember Christopher Wolfe, who taught at Marquette, telling me always that he wanted to retire. To you know, going to a nicer place. I mean, so now they're definitely enjoying Texas. Maybe it's they chose a very hot place for that. But no, it's definitely not the ice of Milwaukee. But Raleigh is a beautiful place, and it does have an amazing university presence.
Mm-hmm. It's
it may be one of the best places in the world in mm-hmm. in terms of university mm-hmm. life.
Yeah.
So
with Duke
triangle,
and the University of North yes. Carolina at Chapel
and
Hill
NC State,
and NC
right.
State.
And a
yeah.
bunch of other smaller, you know, mm-hmm. university institutions mm-hmm. around. I would say that Raleigh is an example of a university city. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The percentage of PhD students is the highest compared to the population.
Wow.
And
mm-hmm.
PhD, not students, I mean PhDs, really.
Yes, okay.
So also Raleigh is a very good growing Catholic community. Mm-hmm. The bishop mm-hmm. has been extremely mm-hmm. welcoming, mm-hmm. and he wrote a very good letter mm-hmm. to, you know, present the center and support us. And it's growing. Raleigh has an amazing growing economics.
Mm-hmm.
So it's one of the best growing places, mm-hmm. economically speaking, in the mm-hmm. entire country.
Mm-hmm.
And it does have a presence. It does have an interesting presence of business, too. It's a place mm-hmm. in which business does research
mm-hmm.
in also yes. in a way that can be in harmony with university research.
Okay.
So the research park in Raleigh
RTP.
Is right
yeah.
is an extremely interesting piece of the puzzle. What makes Raleigh so interesting yeah. for people who want to make an impact on culture and research at the university level. So you put all these things together, and then we came here, we started mm-hmm. traveling to Raleigh, and we immediately got in touch with very good people who mm-hmm. got excited about what we were doing.
Mm-hmm.
So at that point we had a board meeting, and we tried to compare the differences between, you know, all the places we had mm-hmm. been, and we thought, well, I mean, there is no Catholic institution in Raleigh, so mm-hmm. from that viewpoint, the presence of a Catholic college mm-hmm. would add something mm-hmm. to the overall, you know, culture mm-hmm. of the place.
Definitely.
So other institutions would welcome it too if mm-hmm. we had. So. And we've been running several lecture series in the other universities as well, and they've
okay.
been successful. We engaged students, we made a lot of friends. So we figured this was a good place where we can grow faster. It's like when you start playing some sport,
mm-hmm.
you get much better if you play with very good players, right?
Right, absolutely.
So here is a place in which we can immediately play with other mm-hmm. good players,
mm-hmm.
and we can grow faster, and we can have a better impact.
Yeah.
And hopefully Raleigh is going to be a much bigger and richer and wealthier place in the next few years, and the Catholic community is growing very well.
As a result of, okay.
Yes.
So you want to do the online university
mm-hmm.
to grow the presence of the Thomas International Center. That's part of your
yes.
Future plans.
Mm-hmm.
I did see something about a TV show or a TV station on your website. What is that about? Can you touch on that
actually,
a little bit?
Well, actually, we thought at first the online university development will take still some time. We got
okay.
a good grant to develop a portal for the online university.
Okay.
We hope to have that ready by the end of 2017. So we'll
okay.
be able to, in about a year, to actually deliver courses.
Okay.
Now, in the meantime, we wanted also to present the kind of content we would put in the online university.
Okay.
And we thought, let's open a website, a simpler one, which we can share, we can have people see what we are doing and what our university will look like eventually.
Yeah.
So we thought, let's open a website. We can immediately provide some of the classes for the university. And also some more popular videos that people can like, mm-hmm. and they can get the sense of the culture mm-hmm. we are promoting. Mm-hmm. And so I would say that the first idea of having a website with as a sort of TV channel online with
right.
videos
okay. yes.
started as a sort of marketing tool.
Okay,
let's have people see what we are preparing mm-hmm. For the online
yeah.
university.
Yeah.
But then actually everybody got so excited that we thought, wow, I mean, this is something valuable in itself, mm-hmm. so let's keep it up.
Mm-hmm.
So we opened it we presented it last year at our major event, the end of the year event.
Okay.
And we opened it, I think, in between March and April this year.
Okay.
And wow, our impact increased so much. Mm-hmm. I mean, thousands of connections mm-hmm. more, and people who are writing to us, who get interested, they want to help or collaborate.
Mm-hmm.
And still, we haven't really promoted it. So mm-hmm. we are still in the process mm-hmm. of working on the quality of the content. Mm-hmm. And mm-hmm. but people really liked it. So in a sense, it's the first step towards having the portal for the online university.
Okay.
In another sense, it's actually something that we figure out is a great tool for Catholics to mm-hmm. have online,
yes.
and so we
You're
are pursuing
right.
it anyway.
You're right.
And it also helps us organizing better some events in Raleigh, because we mm-hmm. think of the event as something that can be shared with everybody else in the world. So sometimes we need to think better what we want
right.
to have in Raleigh, so
right.
that it can be also a good product
right.
to, you know, deliver to
yeah.
to the whole world. And we want to keep it free, so
I was gonna
with
say,
the exceptions of some copyright material for
mm-hmm.
the university,
mm-hmm.
we are trying to just make it freely available to everybody. So, by the way, I hope that several people will help us because the costs of the website are not, well, it's cheap compared to a physical university, of course.
Right,
I mean,
of course.
But still, we need to pay for it. And so far we had, you know, we could cover the costs with some individual donors.
Okay.
But the more we increase the online TV, the more we need, you know, some small donors to just...
Yes.
Knock the door and online
yeah.
and just
yeah.
help us out. But it's a great tool. It's helping already a lot of people.
I did see that there was a mention there for anybody that would be interested in sponsoring a student as well as making a donation for.
Oh yeah, that's one of the
idea.
Best ways to
yeah.
help us. And not just for the online thing. We have the online TV channel. We have our major event every year. This year is going to be on December on the 3rd of December, which is the first Saturday in December.
Okay.
And we have both a major panel discussion in the morning
okay.
With several prominent guest speakers. And also we have a ball, a dinner.
A big gala
in the evening. And we like to have students come for free to these events.
Mm-hmm.
But these events, of course, we need to cover mm-hmm. the costs. So every year we had some sponsors allowing us to invite students for free.
Okay.
So last year we had, I believe, 5 tables
mm-hmm.
at the gala filled up with students from NC State, UNC, and Duke,
oh, okay.
thanks to some of our sponsors
oh,
who
fantastic.
Bought all the tickets.
Yeah.
So if people want to help us, you know, getting... And by the way, we decided also to make free the panel discussion for students.
Okay.
And so, again, last year we had a sponsor who gave some extra money for covering the costs of the panel so that
okay.
we could make it totally free for the students. Usually adults pay something, like, I can't remember, $20,
$25.
Okay. So this helps us a lot. I mean, we
okay.
definitely want to engage students, and
yeah.
Yeah. but we need some help to
and
do that.
And getting people
yeah.
to help
mm-hmm.
with that program, too.
Yeah.
There is a big concern, and we touched a little bit on this, about the high cost of education, and this is a great way of providing education to students that wouldn't otherwise have the opportunity because it's
mm-hmm.
so expensive. So I'm personally excited about mm-hmm. the opportunity of the Thomas International Center and what it can provide and how you're really setting the stage for
mm-hmm.
How education is going to be delivered in the future. And it's very, very exciting to hear about.
It can help actually also high school and
oh,
home
of course.
Schools too.
Right.
So
right.
having more tools online that can be used can help a lot. Some of the classes we are producing can be can be used very fruitfully with the high school students as well.
Okay.
So we've been talking to some high schools about mm-hmm. these possible developments, mm-hmm. And but also individuals who need to provide either to provide education or
yeah.
to keep a good approach with their own, you know, formation, like an ongoing, you know,
yes,
continuous education. They can benefit from online teaching. I actually have one of our supporters who is a very young businessman who told me, you know, Fulvio, this is my way of, you know, getting a second degree. I love to do that. I want to get stronger in my mm-hmm. faith, in my approach mm-hmm. to culture. But mm-hmm. I have a very busy life now. Mm-hmm. So all I can do is to go home at night maybe and take some courses, mm-hmm. some classes when I have
yeah.
free time.
Yeah.
So I would never be eligible for a formal, you know, institution where I need to be present
to
as
go.
A student.
Mm-hmm.
But I can do mm-hmm. that at a slower, you know, of course, mm-hmm. According to a slower path,
mm-hmm.
but thanks to an online teaching. So mm-hmm. he would be our first adult.
Oh, fantastic.
I'm not sure he's going to be the first,
yeah,
but
okay.
definitely he wants to sign up as soon as
yeah.
we have a formal system to deliver a degree online.
It is a great opportunity.
So, mm-hmm.
There is always room for advancement, especially in understanding our faith and
yes.
the beauty of our church. I don't know if you want to go into talking about a liberal arts education and how the Thomas International Center would ultimately deliver something that like that and how that would differ from our common understanding of what a liberal arts education, especially in the secular mm-hmm. view is. Would you touch on that a little bit? And
well, it's part of what I've already said. I mean,
yes.
Our first goal to really give flesh and blood to our mission is
yeah.
to be able to provide a consistent, complete online curriculum that gives that covers all the liberal arts education that that we need to be educated.
Yes.
So the idea of having a complete liberal arts education core curriculum online, which is informed by an overall idea of what our knowledge is as Catholics,
yes.
the unity of knowledge that informs each part of it, is actually the way to give flesh and blood to our mission. So, and in our vision, of course, if we have a course in one specific discipline in the online, in the liberal education program, it has to make sense compared to an overall vision. So it cannot be like in other universities, which there is no connection whatsoever
right.
between
right.
one
like
discipline and the other.
Mm-hmm.
There has to be a connection. There has
mm-hmm.
to be an overall vision.
Mm-hmm.
So eventually, I can see an institution which professors from different departments have to collaborate to figure
right.
out how that actually works.
Yeah.
It's not that like nobody has all the answers, but that's
mm-hmm.
actually a goal. It's an important goal
mm-hmm.
to have.
Mm-hmm.
So even while producing our courses now,
mm-hmm.
we have a lot of discussions with the scholars about how they actually fit a liberal arts education, which is Catholic. So, and what can we add to some of the disciplines because of the overall unity of knowledge that
mm-hmm.
we should recover from the past? Because unfortunately now we don't have it anymore.
Right.
So it's definitely part of the one. Our current action in terms of producing classes for the future online university
right.
is actually to complete the sketch of what the liberal arts education should be and to have all the viewpoints available online and according to an overall vision, which has to be the Catholic vision.
Yeah.
And again, we are studying a lot. I mean, it's
mm-hmm.
not like, again, nobody has all the answers, but we are studying. We look for partners, and we are talking to several colleagues in other universities
yeah.
as well.
Yeah.
But this is definitely the way to incarnate our
mm-hmm.
mission.
Mm-hmm.
So otherwise, it becomes just an abstract statement.
It does. How do you draw colleagues and from other universities that might be interested in being a part of this program?
Well, there are one way is just through our lecture series.
Okay.
We usually take advantage of our lectures
mm-hmm.
to create connections that can
mm-hmm.
benefit. For example, actually, last week we had for the entire week, we had a guest scholar here from Notre Dame.
Wow.
is a very good friend who entered our advisory board. Okay. His name is David O'Connor. He's an expert in ancient philosophy.
Okay.
And this is something students who will listen to us should know. He's also an expert in Tolkien. And so he loves to talk about Tolkien and philosophy from a Catholic perspective.
Mm-hmm.
And he has been here the whole week to structure some courses for our online program.
Okay.
And he also shot some classes on Tolkien and philosophy.
Oh, fantastic.
So, and that's with wonderful. Him, we've been working a lot on what courses we're going to need in the future, what other professor we might want to get involved, and, mistakes we made with some of the classes, ways to improve. And this is something, unfortunately, we were supposed to have also a public lecture with him in Raleigh, and we had to cancel that for,
logistics.
logistics, right. But this is what we are trying to do with several other French scholars. We want to bring them in, work with them on the vision, on the courses we need, on other colleagues to get involved, and we also want them to deliver some lectures or seminars here in town.
Okay.
And this is one way to do it. The other way is just virtual, is online. I mean, we're eventually want to outsource several of our collaborators.
Mm-hmm.
So we are, and our websites are actually serving this purpose very well. I mean, there are several scholars, and I like to say that there are several even young scholars, PhD students, who are contacting us, asking how they can help or they can collaborate somehow. And this is great. I mean, a time is coming when we will have all the tools we need to have all these people collaborate in just one undertaking. Because, again, the online system breaks every barrier. Hmm? So I think that I can see a future in which we're going to have hundreds of good Catholic scholars involved with our system from all over the world.
Yeah.
And it's really happening, even though right now it's a very small piece of it going on.
It's a very exciting time to see the plans that you have that are unfolding, and also how forward-thinking you are with the university prospects and how it can grow, and your experience with philosophy and law and how it's all coming together, and the collaborators that are a part of it too. It's all very exciting, and I know that there are a lot of people that are excited here in Raleigh, North Carolina to have you here and to be putting this together here. So is there anything else that you would like to add to what we've talked about and share? And
well, we talked about many things.
We did.
Yes. I mean, what can I say? I'm a scholar, and I'm also the director of the center. So
yes.
I cannot get tired of telling people that we need some help.
Of course.
And I would say that we need help, especially on the business side. I would like to, you're right, there are a lot of people who are very excited about what we're doing.
Right.
I would love to have some of those people who have expertise in business to help us out more directly, because I think we do have all the intellectual tools we need.
Yeah, sounds
but
like
now
it.
It's like we are dealing with the startup, even though we are beyond the startup moment.
Yeah.
But we need to create something that will be able to have a strong impact, but that will actually work. Not waste any resource.
Right.
And we need some help in that department. So if somebody who is listening to us has help to provide in that department, that would be a treasure.
Okay.
And also, we need also some more financial support, especially for, at this point we can increase our, we can make the whole process faster and increase our production if we get more support. I mean, we are doing everything we can with what we have. And I can share with you that we couldn't do everything we are doing without a lot of in-kind donations. I mean, there are people who are committing so much time and resources that if I give a number to it, would be probably close to $300,000 or $400,000 a
That's
year,
fantastic.
Just in kind.
Yeah.
But this is also our power. I mean, in the Catholic world, in God's design, great ventures are not something that individuals can do. I mean, we exist as a community. God created us not as a one being, but as a community of being. Mm-hmm. So we are supposed to exist as a community, and the church is the body of Christ existing in the community. That means that everything great has to be an expression of a community. Mm-hmm. So we're not supposed to do anything like this alone. Nothing big will come just from one person.
Exactly.
So we need to make this much more of the outcome of a community that does really want it. And that's why somehow I'm glad, even though it makes my life much more difficult, not to have a multi-billionaire behind us, because that would be a very limited thing. I mean, a multi-billionaire might just run the show, yeah, or something that he thinks is right, but maybe he doesn't have enough experience, mm-hmm, of education, he's not, mm-hmm, a scholar, maybe he knows something very well but doesn't know other things very well. I think that what we need is a mixture of several things. It's difficult to put leaders together. Mm-hmm. Sometimes I notice, this is part of my experience, everybody wants to do his own thing. And there are actually people with a lot of resources, good businessmen, who do want to do something good, but they don't share the leadership. Mm-hmm. And so in a sense, they want to control even people who know more than they do in other areas. Mm-hmm. So I would say that I have, and we have as Thomas International, a great leadership in culture. Mm-hmm. And now we need good leaders who can join the team, who do, right, have the power to do that. Right. But it's great that in our history, money didn't come first. Mm-hmm. Financial resources didn't come first. We need to work on the ideal and the vision first. Mm-hmm. But now we need to put together leaders who actually also have some power in the financial, mm-hmm, world. So, and we can make everything go faster and better, because they do have something we don't have. They know how to make things successful sometimes. Let's give everybody his due, I mean, or her due.
Right.
I mean, I envy people who can make a company very successful. Mm-hmm. So, but they would need us to create a good Catholic, yeah, educational institution.
Yeah.
So let's just join forces and
together.
But I would say that right now we are very strong in terms of education,
mm-hmm,
but we definitely need help at this
business.
Point in the business. We need to raise more resources, mm-hmm, and that's why I welcome, we have some friends who are helping us more in development,
yeah, right,
but we need more. We need much more. And
so
this is the right time, which some wealthier donor might show up and,
right,
you know, provide,
right,
some missing
the missing
ingredients
link that you,
right,
need for the Thomas International, yes, Center. So in the business component, mm-hmm, end. So if anybody is out there that is available to help with that,
yes,
you'd certainly appreciate it. Okay, so we've certainly spent a lot of time together, Dr. Blasi, and
yes,
I really appreciate this opportunity. And be assured of my humble prayers for this
really
venture and for your presence here in North Carolina. And
thank
you so much for the witness of your faith.
Thank you.
It's a beautiful thing, and I appreciate that. And should anyone be interested in getting some more information about the Thomas International Center, they can go to ticenter.net. This interview will also be available on that website. And listeners, remember, we need your support. Please support your Catholic radio station, WFNE 103.5 FM. St. Thomas Aquinas, pray for us.